Ja, ein herzliches Willkommen. Ich begrüße Sie zu unserer heutigen Portfolio Manager Konferenz. Mein Name ist Florian Koch. Ich bin Senior Investment Analyst bei Scope. Bevor wir anfangen, einen kurzen Hinweis. Falls Sie Fragen haben, können Sie diese gerne über das Chatfenster stellen. Immer mehr aktive Fondsstrategien berücksichtigen bei Ihrem Investmentprozess die 17 Ziele für eine nachhaltige Entwicklung der Vereinten Nationen. Wir wollen daher heute da genauer darüber sprechen, inwiefern sich die Bekämpfung von Armut und Klimawandel auf der einen Seite mit den Renditechancen eines US-Aktienportfolios auf der anderen Seite verbinden lassen. Wir haben dazu einen Gesprächspartner von Allianz Bernstein eingeladen. Wir sprechen heute mit Benjamin Rixecker. Er ist Research Analyst und Co-Fondsmanager des US Sustainable Thematic Equity Portfolio. Hello, Ben. It's nice to have you with us. Before we start with our agenda, could you please give us some information to your position and Allianz Bernstein, please?
Sure, thank you, Florian, and great to have you. Thank you for the invitation today. So the fund itself is a part of a broader suite of a thematic approach to investing. And for our portfolio, what I do is I cover the technology sector, specifically the hardware opportunities that exist within the technology sector, again, across our US, global, and international products. And then I'm also a portfolio manager along with Daniel Rorty on the US strategy, which we'll be digging into today. The product itself goes back quite some time, back to 2001, and we've been taking this unique thematic approach to investing since then. But really, the relevant time period for your investors and your audience is the 2013 period going forward, which is when Dan Rorty assumed ownership and CIO position of the fund.
Okay, thank you, Ben. Well, let us speak about the situation in the US first, and especially about the Green New Deal. So the main goal is to reduce America's greenhouse gas emissions to net zero by 2030. So Joe Biden made climate change as a top priority, and at present, the Green New Deal is just a roadmap for what America needs to do to address to a climate change. But the solution says that US must take a leading role in reducing emissions. So from your point of view, do you think 2030 is realistic here?
Yeah, it's a good question. So I believe that the actual target is to cut in half the number of emissions by 2030 and to go fully net zero by 2050, as well as to go carbon pollution free from the power generation sector by 2035. So these are ambitious goals, right? We have a significant economy here in the United States, and it would require participation all throughout the end of the spectrum, whether it's industry, so much greater carbon capture. We'll need a carbon tax likely to achieve this. Significant changes in the transportation aspect of society. But also households, right? We're going to need greater focus on energy efficiency, on things like heat sinks and different forms of appliances. And so it is an ambitious goal. It's an ambitious target. What I think is more important is not whether we'll actually achieve the goals by 2030 and by 2050, but just the fact that they're out there as a marker and saying, this is where America is headed. This is where our commitment is at the national level. And importantly, it sets a landscape where it invites in the private sector. It says, look, private sector, this is where we're headed, and we need your innovation. We need your solutions to help us to get there. And that's really, I think, the exciting part for investors is that this marker, this stake is in the ground, and now the private sector can move along and understand where regulation is headed and where legislation is headed. But what's interesting is if you go back 4 years ago to Joe Biden's predecessor, President Trump, when he was elected, there was a lot of fear that the move towards sustainability, towards environmental preservation would be derailed because here's the United States pulling out of the Paris Climate Accords, and many of the stocks related to these opportunities underperformed initially. But what happened was underneath that, the mayors of cities, the governors of many of these states came forward and said, we're committed to progressing these areas. And companies themselves said, we want to invest in a cleaner future. So it's great that the Biden administration is really putting forth these goals, but underneath this is a very strong momentum towards creating cleaner cities, bringing people out of poverty, and really advancing these climate goals. So again, it's an important marker. It'll invite in the private sector, but whether we actually achieve them, again, this is an unstoppable force and just an accelerant, we believe, towards the trends already in place.
Okay, that's interesting. But from your point of view, how has the COVID-19 pandemic changed the mindset of investors towards issues of sustainability and ESG?
It's a great question. Look, the world has changed over the last 12 months. And I'd say it's changed, and really the impact of COVID-19 comes in two dimensions. The first dimension is issues of sustainability are no longer things that just occur elsewhere in other parts of the world. They're not just things that live in the emerging markets. We saw just how important access to healthcare, high quality healthcare, was in the pandemic. We saw the importance of and how you access the financial system changed during the pandemic. We saw issues of gender equality and racial equality come to the forefront. And so I'd say one of the important lessons in the developments of the last 12 months related to the COVID-19 situation is just that sustainability has become tangible, and these issues have become real for many individuals that are investors and our clients. And so there's a greater aptitude and a greater attention and desire to bring those and invest around these opportunities. The second is just the how we analyze companies themselves, right? So in the midst of the pandemic, you couldn't separate out your expectation and your forecast for growth without also having a forecast for the health crisis and whether we were going to make progress against that. There is no ex-COVID GDP number, right? Similarly, what we learned as investors is you cannot separate out an analysis of a company's financial picture separate from how it treats its employees, its environmental footprint. What we saw and what COVID-19 has taught us, these last 12 months have taught us, these are intertwined. Sustainability issues, ESG issues, are just as important and inform financial forecasts for companies. And so I'd say just the reality of how important an integration of ESG, a consideration of sustainable issues, has become over the last 12 months, just because you cannot separate these issues. They're very much intertwined. And that's an important lesson we've learned over the last 12 months.
Okay, thank you. Today we also want to speak about your asymmetric portfolio. So for the beginning, could you please give us some facts? So when was the fund launched? What is the fund size? And especially, what was the idea behind to create this fund?
So the US fund goes back to 2001, and from its early days, it always had a thematic focus, which means rather than start with a benchmark such as the MSCI ACWI or the S&P 500, and then decide, do we want to overweight or underweight sectors? Look, the benchmarks reflect yesterday's winners, so they're backward looking. Our approach and our research focus has been forward. How is the world changing? What kind of disruption are we seeing? What kind of challenges will the world face? What does the world look like 5 years from now? And so in the early days of this fund, it's always taken that forward looking view, that thematic approach. And fast forward to 2013, Dan Rorty took over as CIO and really started to integrate an analysis of ESG into the fundamental view of every company in the portfolio back then. In 2015, the UN came out with the Sustainable Development Goals, and our research really shifted to, and had been for many years, focused on issues of sustainability. And so in 2016, we adopted the UN Sustainable Development Goals, which we'll talk about at the core of our research effort. And the fund has grown. So the Lux Fund today on the US side is around $700 million in assets, and our US products in total around $12 billion. And our suite of products that we manage global and international is as much as $20 billion. So a bit of the history of the fund and how we got to today.
Okay, let us have a look on the next page. So this one is this page which is showing the three themes. So the sustainability US thematic portfolio is considering the 17 UN goals in the investment process. As we can see, the fund focuses on climate, health, and empowerment. So could you please tell us, why are you particularly focusing on these three themes? Could you please tell us what the individual points mean?
Sure. So this is actually just an overview of the process. The three themes come in two more pages right there. There you go. So why do we choose these themes? Again, we have a long history of looking forward. Where's the world headed? Trying to identify change that exists in the world. And these are the three themes that we've invested in for our clients. Why did we pick climate, health, and empowerment? Well, again, it comes back to this framework which came out from the United Nations called the UN Sustainable Development Goals. And what we've done is sat through and read through this framework. There are 17 broad goals, but underneath that, there's 169 targets that tell investors, tell the world what all of these countries have signed on to and they're trying to make progress against. And if you read this framework, which we spent several years digging into, what you come up to is an understanding of the areas that are trying to make progress relate to the broad issues and the broad buckets of issues related to climate, issues related to health, and issues related to empowerment. And so the themes that they exist, again, come out of that framework and our understanding of the opportunities that exist for the private sector to play there. And then you see sub-themes or sub-points underneath there. So clean energy is definitely a focus of the UN framework, trying to make progress, again, all of these countries around the world. Sustainable transportation, clean reforms of transportation. On the right-hand side, access to the financial system, financial security, and also information and communication technologies that will enable growth and innovation. So the three themes as they exist today are really coming out of that framework, the United Nations Development Goals. And what's interesting is, again, this is a 15-year framework. So the UN is saying this is what we want to make progress against for the next 15 years through 2030. And they're as relevant today as they were 12 months ago. What's interesting is many of these themes that you see on this page saw accelerating growth during a period of decelerating economic activity in the economy. So health opportunities saw significant growth and acceleration as we tried to understand COVID-19, the virus, and to bring vaccines to market. On the empowerment side, fintech solutions saw accelerating growth because of how individuals access the financial system. And so these themes, again, they tie back to the UN SDGs, but they're seeing accelerating growth because of what we're seeing in the broader economy.
Okay, but is it more like that you think these goals open the greatest performance opportunities for investors, or should these offer the greatest potential for positive impacts?
Great question. So first and foremost, again, we think these are dynamic and powerful profit opportunities for the private sector, companies that you and I can invest in. And so the great thing about these three themes is they're quite broad, right? Issues of climate, health, and empowerment cover a lot of ground. And so that gives us a great area to expect from an investment perspective. But prices change in the market, and so the opportunities will shift. And also technology development changes over time. For instance, battery technology is advancing rapidly. We're seeing the growth of electric vehicles and electrification of automobiles. And so the opportunities as we see it will shift within these different areas. So we'll take profits from, say, the financial security theme and invest in sustainable transportation, an area of growth for us, or sustainable infrastructure, which is listed on the right-hand side as economies are trying to re-stimulate their economies and to see growth and build out infrastructure. There are opportunities that exist there. So our exposures will change. And the great thing about this framework, it's broad enough where we have those opportunities to shift exposures if warranted.
Okay. Investing has always to do with value and price. So many stocks, especially in the US, are trading above their 200 moving average, and multiples of many stocks are quite high. I think in the US, nearly 24 PE ratio. So also high in comparison to the past. Would you agree that the current valuations make it for you as a fund manager more difficult to construct an attractive portfolio for investors?
And actually, it's interesting you're asking this question now. There was one that came in over the chat, which is a related question, which is there a danger of an ESG bubble? And many high flyers have strong PEs at the moment. And so I'll answer them both, which is to say, if you look at ESG overall, certainly you're seeing flows into sustainability-focused strategies, into ESG strategies. And there's been a study by several firms into whether those firms and the portfolios themselves are seeing greater valuations than the market overall. And the market has appreciated, and so have these portfolios. So in aggregate, the conclusion was that these ESG funds are not more expensive than the broader market. But certainly there are parts of the market which are expensive today. And as you mentioned, there are certainly some darlings or some companies which are poster children for sustainability, whether it's water companies that are pure play opportunities in terms of water or renewable energy. Some of those companies have seen very strong appreciation in the last 12 months and strong PEs. Take a company like Tesla, which has more than tripled over a 12-month period. And it's our job to, again, move between and look at the opportunities across all of our areas. And so we've been taking profits in some of these themes. I mentioned financial technology, some of our medical innovation companies we've taken profits in where there are very high PEs and the market is pricing in a very strong growth, and moving it into areas where the valuation is not fully reflecting the opportunities. And infrastructure is an area that I mentioned. So I would say it's not true that there's a bubble in ESG stocks, partly because there is no standard way to say what's an ESG company versus not. there are a sub-segment of parts of the market and sub-themes where they have richer valuations. I'll absolutely grant that. And that's why you need to have a broader lens and a broader framework to then shift those exposures within your portfolio to companies which are undervalued. And I mentioned that infrastructure area is an area of increasing research and investment for us.
Okay. On the following slides, we see some examples of the 17 UN goals. So maybe you can give us some information or more details on the 17 goals. Would be very interesting for the audience.
Yeah, so this goal is, the great thing about it is it's recognizable. So everybody's heard of the United Nations, right? 193 nations around the world came together and said, what do we want to make progress against for 15 years? It came out in 2015, it would run through 2030. And as investors, again, as thematic investors, we want to know where the world is headed. And here we have a 15-year view on what the world is trying to make progress against. So there are 17 broad goals. You can see some of the nice, colorful icons here. Good health and well-being, advancing clean energy, fostering innovation, bringing about clean water. But the challenge is you can't just stop there. Underneath there is 169 specific targets. And we've actually gone through and determined about half of those targets relate to policy, and about half of those targets relate to things that the private sector can offer solutions to. And so the great thing as investors is it's simple to understand, 17 easy to read goals, but then you really need to do the work to understand where the investable opportunity is, and that's what we've done. Importantly, there's a significant role for the private sector to play here. This cannot be accomplished. Eliminating poverty, bringing people into the financial system can't be accomplished by government spending alone, cannot be accomplished purely through philanthropy and non-government organizations, NGOs. You need the private sector's participation. And so both the opportunity is vast, the understanding of it, you really need to do some digging and really unpack the framework. And again, the role for the private sector is quite strong. So to us, it was natural for us to really adopt this framework at the core of our thematic selection. And it absolutely is driving strong returns for our clients. So a very important framework, which is getting more recognition now. And that's why it really matters to us as thematic investors.
Okay. So just please go on with your further information regarding the investment process. So up to now, we just heard the general information. So now we are coming to the special investment process to the fund. So maybe just you can give us some information how you manage the fund. So especially what are the big brackets for the fund and how do you determine the investment universe and how do you select stocks?
So we just talked about this framework from the United Nations. And as I mentioned, there's 169 specific targets. For example, one of those specific targets is to cut in half the number of deaths from automobile accidents by 2030. Over a million people die in automobiles every year. And there's a specific goal to try and make progress in this area. What we've done is identified products and services that the private sector can offer that will help to advance and directly address a specific target within this framework. And we've come up with 140 products and services, again, that can be offered by the private sector. Then we go out around the world and look for the companies that you and I can invest in that are offering these products and services. And so that's how we determine our universe. Again, start with specific products and services, which tie back to the UN SDGs, and then tying in companies which are offering these products and services. And then what we've done there is also identified what are companies that are offering products and services which run counter to the framework. And these are areas such as alcohol, coal, gambling, tobacco, prisons, et cetera. And so if a company is offering a product and service in this area, that is a misalignment in our view, and it's not going to exist. That company won't be into our universe. So for all of these companies that, again, have that positive alignment, we estimate the revenue exposure they offer in these products and services. And that's how we build out that broad universe. So one question is this something that can be easily replicated? I'd say it's not, it hasn't been to date. And that's because there is some nuance in your understanding of the SDGs. There's some estimate in terms of the amount of revenue exposure a company can have. And the definitions that one investor may have may change and be different than another one. And so to date, we haven't seen this become commoditized or replicated in the market. There are other services which use big data to try and bring about and pull this information. But we found that that leaves some loopholes and some incorrect translation. And so we've actually, again, spent several years just going through and making this analysis on our own. And so that's how we go about creating our universe. It's over 2,000 companies on a global basis and over 800 aligned companies from the US market perspective.
Okay, so on the next slides, we see some examples. Maybe just you can just give us some more information regarding the investment process.
Sure, so again, we start with a thematic standpoint. Where is the world headed? That thematic view is informed by the UN framework, which tells us for the next 15 years what governments around the world are trying to make progress against and trying to invite the private sector into. Then we identify companies offering products and services that are helping to address the UN SDGs and the targets there. But that only brings you so far. You have companies, a vast number of companies, and you need to bring it down to an individual basis. And for every company that we're considering for our investment portfolios, we put it through this framework. It's a, we call it a private equity-like mentality because our view is a bit further than traditional analysis. So many traditional investors analyze a company's prospects over the next, say, 1 to 2 to 3 years. Our forecasts go out 5 years. So we have a 5-year view for every investment that we're considering. And we estimate return potential, we estimate the risk profile, and then we look at the differences between the two. So on the return side, we're forecasting out revenues, profits, cash flows for this business over 5 years, discounting those back to today. We use the stock price today to come up with an expected rate of return or an IRR value. On the risk side, we look forward and we say, what are the biggest risks facing this business? We analyze the business on 6 big buckets, environmental, social, and governance issues, as well as your traditional balance sheet, financial considerations, strategic and operational issues. And we form a view on the riskiness of this business. And again, here we're not outsourcing this assessment, so we don't buy ratings from a firm like MSCI. We do the work ourselves and we come up with our own scores, our own view of these companies. And so we have an individual risk profile, an individual risk hurdle for every company. And then we compare that return potential, which incorporates today's stock price, versus that risk hurdle, and we get a spread between those two values. Why this is important? This same framework we apply across all of our themes. And so we can compare a water utility to a software firm on the same basis. And so as we went through last year, we saw significant opportunities in March and April to invest in clean transportation opportunities, to invest in fintech. And as we moved through the year, many of those companies were very strong performers. And the spreads between the risk and return for them was detracting and actually narrowing and becoming negative. We were taking profits and reallocating capital into infrastructure and other areas which were undervalued on this framework. So this is important because it really brings that risk discipline, that sell discipline to these very dynamic thematic opportunities. And it tells us where these opportunities are actually priced in the market.
Okay, a very interesting slide is the next one. So this one is showing the portfolio. The final portfolio is consisting of 30 to 60 stocks, and the watch list, I would say, is from 200 to 300 stocks. So mm-hmm. Which means the portfolio is not very diversified, I would say. So what is in terms of risk? Do you feel comfortable with this number of stocks, or would you say this is just a normal environment and there is always a risk environment where we have less or more stocks?
Good question. So we walked through the process again, how we start. It starts with those broad themes, climate, health, and empowerment, informed by the SDGs. Again, aligned companies, that's how we build our universe. And then from there, it's the analysts, really intelligence, their experience, as well as some quantitative tools that help us to refine to the companies that we're going to evaluate for consideration in the portfolio. And those go through that rigorous bottoms-up framework that I mentioned. 30 to 60 on the shorter end or on the lower end may sound very concentrated. It's around 45 to 50 names in the portfolio today. And importantly, there's nice diversification within the portfolio. So we don't have any 5%, any 7% exposures in individual positions. There's nice balance within our exposures. Most of our companies are in the, say, 1.5% to 2.5% weight. So there's not overly concentration. The exposures are spread out between the themes. So roughly speaking, about a third in each of those buckets of climate, health, and empowerment. And again, that will be determined by the risk reward in the individual positions themselves. And then we do monitor risk, both at the theme level, so what themes are working, what's been working in the market. We look at our exposures from a quantitative perspective, our exposure to growth, to value, to momentum, to stock-specific risk on a biweekly basis to bring, again, greater risk control in the portfolio. And really, the proof is in the performance and the returns that we've been able to deliver for clients. So being very intelligent, being able to see the future and identify the winners, but then take profits and move on in a disciplined fashion as prices appreciate. So it is really a very strong performance and a really strong process, and there's risk controls all throughout that process.
Okay. We should really speak about the performance of the fund. So here we see the performance of the fund in relation to the S&P 500 index. And my first question here is, as we have a strong allocation in the technology sector, so would it make more sense to compare the fund to a technology index like the NASDAQ?
It's a good question. I'd say we'll look at the sector exposures in a few slides. You'll find that certainly technology, there's a healthy exposure there because technology enables a lot of the change that we're seeing in the world around us. Everything from renewable energy. You cannot have a wind turbine without power semiconductors at the heart of that turbine to translate that wind energy into usable electricity. Within the automobile space, you can't have clean transportation without technology solutions in semiconductors and sensors and some of those inverters, for instance. And so technology is a healthy exposure in the portfolio. It's about a little over a quarter, but that will change and ebb and flow again as valuations move in the market. And so I would say certainly the S&P is the relevant marker, if you will, for the portfolio because the exposures will change over time. And they're really driven by the thematic emphasis, where those theme opportunities are developing, as well as the bottoms-up discipline. And so I would again, believe that S&P 500 is as relevant a benchmark as anything else. One question that we often get is, what environments are favorable for the funds? You see very strong returns over time in this portfolio. The last, I'd say 2020, there were some favorable tailwinds, which are the growth tailwind that existed in the market, as well as companies that had quality were also rewarded. And those are exposures which you would typically see in our themes, right? We're going to be a little more exposed to growth and also a little more and heavily exposed to quality type of businesses. And so that was a tailwind for us, but we outperformed that quite dramatically. And also this year, we're seeing a bit of a pullback in those areas, and we've outperformed that broader tailwind. But again, those are some of the ebbs and flows. So I do believe S&P is the relevant benchmark. We do have strong technology exposure, but that will change and shift over time.
Okay. The first quarter of this year was positive, but in relation to the performance of the S&P, negative. So what are the reasons and what do you expect the fund to deliver an outperformance for the next quarters? Are there certain factor exposures that the portfolio tends to possess? So we see a strong outperformance, especially over 1 year, though, which was very strong. So what is different from the first quarter to the last year?
Good question. And I alluded to it a bit in my previous answer, which is there was a growth tailwind in the market last year and also quality. Companies that had strong balance sheets saw strong returns in 2020. With the start of the approval of the vaccines back in early November, the Moderna and the Pfizer vaccines, we saw a shift in the leadership of the market and value, which had been underperforming for quite some time, rallied quite dramatically. The five-month period from November through March of this year was one of the strongest rallies towards value that we've seen since 2000. It was either the top or the top rolling five-month period, the top relative performance for value versus growth. So you had a very strong move towards cyclicals and value sectors. The question that you have to ask yourself is market leadership. Are we going to see financials, energy, and materials and industrials? Is that really what's going to lead the market going forward in an unsustained basis? There are certainly secular challenges towards energy, for instance. As I mentioned earlier, the shift towards renewable energy, those tend to be more industrial types of investments rather than the traditional oil and gas. And so we've had this very strong rotation, the portfolio that was a headwind for this portfolio. But again, going forward, we believe the economic growth will be more muted, which tends to favor, again, growth type of companies. And as I mentioned earlier, we're investing in infrastructure and more cyclicality in the portfolio, so we should be able to benefit. And the themes that we talked about, we've made progress in the last 12 months, but because of demographics, we're going to have more and more individuals to feed. to put in cities and make those cities clean for the migration to clean energy. We're on the front end of adoption of electric vehicles and the access to healthcare. That dynamic has not been met in any dramatic way. So the drivers of this portfolio are very much intact, and we're very excited about the opportunities that exist from here.
Okay. We should also speak about the allocation of the fund. So top holdings and sector allocations are key to generate performance and manage risk. Here we can see the current allocation of the portfolio. If we take a look at the top holding on the right-hand side, we see that the portfolio is mostly focusing on health and climate, with one exception, the SVB Financial, that is standing for empowerment. So empowerment in general is not easy to define from my point of view. Could you please tell us more about SVB?
Yes, I'd grant you that empowerment doesn't exactly strike a chord in many ways. It's a general term, but what it allows and what it really speaks to is providing access. So access to the financial system, access to healthcare, access to the internet and information, and also, you know, empowerment, enabling change, enabling growth, enabling innovation. So empowerment really speaks to these areas. And again, on the financial side, one of the things we're very focused on, and the UN is very focused on, is access to the financial system. We don't own many banks in the portfolio. Many large banks, financial institutions, they cater to corporations. They provide funding for growth in these corporations, capital spending. The UN is not focused on growing this area. They're focused on providing microfinance loans and bringing people into the financial system. So who is SVB Financial? It stands for Silicon Valley Bank. So it is a bank, but it's different than your average bank. It sits in the heart of Silicon Valley in the United States and California. And what it does is it funds innovation. They have unique expertise around things like life sciences, artificial intelligence, cybersecurity, and they are lending into startups, to companies that may have raised money through their friends and family, and they're looking to get a bridge loan before they can get to the capital markets and receive more funding and grow their business. And they're funding into these startups. And because of that unique domain expertise in these subject areas, they can understand those risks better than most traditional financial institutions. So they're lending into these areas. They're also taking equity stakes in these companies, and they've seen explosive growth in their business. In the last quarter, they had $40 billion in client inflows, over 40% loan growth annualized year over year. Why is that? Innovation is alive and well. Again, they're funding innovation. They have unique expertise, and they're meeting a need that exists in the world. And so a very dynamic company, but it's not a traditional bank. It's one that, again, its merits warrant investment from our perspective, and it's one of our top holdings today. And it's been our top contributor this year.
Okay, very interesting. So we should also speak about attribution over the 12 months. On the left-hand side, we see that health was the main driver over the last 12 months. My interpretation is that it could be well supported by the corona crisis, which is hopefully just a one-time event. Are there any other reasons why health could be still attractive as a major theme in the fund?
Yeah, it's interesting. If you look at health and you go back to the beginning of last year, and as an investor, you say, okay, I'm recognizing that there's a global pandemic or this coronavirus is really getting out of control. I'm going to go overweight healthcare. If you just bought an index to replicate that market, you'd be sorely disappointed. So healthcare as a sector actually underperformed the market last year, believe it or not. So I believe the market was up 18% in 2020 in terms of the S&P, and the healthcare sector was up 13%. So it underperformed despite a global pandemic. And yet our exposures dramatically outperformed. So our health theme in terms of the exposures and the aggregate performance of our holdings was up over 30% last year. Why is that? We're focused on medical innovation, companies providing the tools for researchers to understand disease, to bring new novel therapies to market. We're invested in diagnostic firms involved in the testing. We've seen a significant amount of testing in this environment. And we're also involved in companies providing access to healthcare. We saw during the pandemic access to high quality healthcare through telemedicine and other novel approaches was very, very important. And so it was a very strong performer last year. But again, healthcare is not universal, and there are different ways to invest in it. So now we've actually taken profits from many of the companies involved in bringing new novel therapies to market, the testing and the packaging companies, which are seeing elevated valuations. what's under pressure is healthcare businesses where there's been elective surgeries, which have been put off, right? If you have a cataract surgery, you want to go in for an eye improvement, maybe you put that off during the pandemic, but now that's starting to come back. And so our exposures have shifted in some cases to these areas where there's more elective surgeries. But we do think that medical innovation testing will continue to see strong demand. We're not likely to see the broad population reach a point where there won't be the virus anymore, that so-called herd immunity. It just seems like that's a missing target at this point. So we're going to see continued growth around testing and bringing innovation to market. So it was a very strong performer. Our exposures have shifted a bit, and we continue to see opportunities in the months ahead.
Okay. We also see Apple as one example to protect the climate. That does not make sense at first, but I think you have good reasons. So could you please describe why do you think Apple is protecting the climate?
Sure. So when most people think of Apple, they think of the device, right? Maybe they have an iPhone or an iPad or a Mac. I'm tuning in from my MacBook here today. What we are interested in with Apple, you can make a case that they provide access to the internet. So one of the things the UN is trying to accomplish is provide greater access to the internet, and they certainly do that. They have a platform for small and medium businesses to sell into and developers. The reason that it sends out a climate for us is actually, again, going back to the UN SDGs, SDG number 12 speaks to consumption and production and sustainable consumption and production. What it's trying to do is to separate GDP growth from the use of primary resources or environmental resources. And Apple is, because of its leadership in the industry as one of the largest technology firms, the vastness of its supply chain, has a very strong ability to influence and decouple this growth, economic growth, from the use of resources. And so what does Apple do? Well, they've gone down a road many years ago to try and adopt more of a circular model in terms of their production. So the global economy, we only recycle about 10%, 9 to 10% of our materials today actually gets recycled. In terms of Apple, they've in 2017, they laid out a goal to have all of their products use only recycled material or come from renewable sources. So they want all the parts of a phone to come from renewable sources and from recycled material. On their packaging side, they're going to 100% sustainable packaging. They moved to wood fibers from plastic, for instance. Many of their products have a significant amount of recycled content. In 2019, over 100 parts had 46% recycled content. The enclosure that my MacBook is sitting in is 100% renewable and recycled aluminum. And so again, there's a great intentionality. Apple, because of its influence in the supply chain, has a significant role to play around achieving a circular economy. And there's both intentionality and its strong content that's growing within their business. So that's why it sits within climate, again, related to sustainable production and consumption, which we believe Apple is a leader.
Okay, thanks. But this is the current situation, but what are your expectations regarding the upcoming months and years? Where do you see drivers for investment themes, and how have you positioned your fund to profit from this?
Sure. If you go forward a slide to the holdings, Florian, you'll see our current exposure. So as I mentioned, roughly a third, we've brought down our health exposure. So you talked about how health was such a strong contributor. Again, we've taken profits from there, moved into empowerment, and that's sustainable infrastructure opportunity. So we do anticipate a stimulus plan. There's $2 trillion stimulus plan, which is on the table in the US. Germany and other countries are stimulating their economies to cleaner forms of power generation, transportation. So the areas that we see, again, very significant growth on the transportation side, sustainable transportation, you can see some of the exposures that we have there. Resource efficiency, energy efficiency is an area that we'll see significant growth in our view in the quarters and the years ahead. And then again, infrastructure, which I mentioned, that can be the electric grid infrastructure, moving to a smarter form of an electric grid. The cities themselves need to be upgraded. The physical infrastructure needs to be upgraded. And we're investing in some of those opportunities. So our exposures are not static, and they're really informed by the valuations from a bottom-up perspective. And we see significant opportunities in the world ahead in some of these areas, which I mentioned.
Okay. Here we see that the portfolio has a strong exposure to a few SDGs that represent economic growth, health, and clean energy. Do you internationally target a specific SDGs based on the environment, or what might be the driving this?
So we do believe that all 17 SDGs are investable, but not equally so. And as you point out here, the exposures in the portfolio are they're not spread equally. It's not a top-down view. So as portfolio managers, we don't say we want to have this much exposure to clean energy, this much exposure to good health and well-being. It's really a combination of the opportunity, some of the stimulus. So what's the environment that we're in, right? The spending that's going towards medical innovation, is that growing or is that shrinking? What are the valuations in each of these areas? And the combination of those has led to strong exposures to innovation in terms of SDG number 9. Good health and well-being. There's a significant amount of people that still lack access to high-quality healthcare. And SDG 3 speaks to companies providing solutions to these areas. Clean energy is something we're on the front end of in terms of the growth in renewables, wind and solar, and the smart grid with battery storage technology coming online. And then, as I mentioned earlier, we were talking about sustainable consumption and production, another area of strong investment. So the exposures here are really dictated by both the investment opportunity as it exists in the market, as well as the valuations that exist in any point in time.
Okay, thank you. On the next slide, we see that you are also offering a global version of your fund. Please give us in the end some information regarding the strategy, though. Is there any other difference than Global Stock Universe?
So the great thing is it's the same team, the same process. We can leverage all the work that we're doing around the SDGs. Those themes are global themes, right? Issues of poverty exist in the developed markets. They exist in the developing markets in a more dramatic fashion as well. Water stress is a very acute need in many emerging markets. And the global opportunity, the global portfolio can invest locally in these areas. You see the same strong performance here, right? So the same themes that we're seeing accelerating growth in the US portfolio, so accelerating growth in this portfolio as well. And it's, as you mentioned, it's just the lens and the investable opportunity has broadened out with the global set.
Okay, on the next page with the 12 month returns. And this is here is the allocation, though it could also be the same than for the US. And finally, we see the different share classes. And I think we will stop here at perfect timing. Thanks again, Ben, for his brilliant insights. Ich fasse nur ganz kurz zusammen. Also wir sehen, dass quasi sich die nachhaltigen Ziele der UN sehr gut mit Renditeoptionen auf einer Fondsstrategie vereinen lassen. Wir haben gesehen, dass gerade auch im US-Bereich sehr viele Möglichkeiten gibt, quasi nachhaltig zu investieren und trotzdem eine sehr gute Performance abzugreifen. Ich danke Ihnen für Ihre Teilnahme heute bei dem Webinar. Ich denke, dass wir auch wirklich sehr interessante Einblicke bekommen haben, auch gerade was das Thema Nachhaltigkeit angeht. Wir setzen unsere Portfolio Manager Webinare weiter fort und würden uns natürlich auch freuen, wenn Sie wieder das nächste Mal dabei sind. Einen schönen Tag aus Frankfurt und auf Wiedersehen.